All right. Hey, good morning, church. All right. Great to see you guys. Super Bowl Sunday. You still came to church. Oh, yeah. That's a victory for the pastor. So, you know, for the Raider fans, I'm sorry. I'm in Niners colors, and, you know, I just gotta go there. You know, boo. You know, when I was in Washington, state of Washington, it was really easy. They only had one team, you know? Everybody just rooted for the Seahawks. But you come down here crying out loud. We got two sports teams for every sport. I mean, you know, basketball, football, baseball, whatever, right? I mean, it's tough. And I want to be the sensitive pastor. I want to support and encourage all of you. So I was going to wear my Joe Montana number 16 jersey, but I didn't do that because in the scriptures they say, don't make your weaker brother stumble. So I didn't want to do that. I'm trying to be biblical. So, you know, just hang in there with me. Hang in there. Well, do you remember your first broken heart? Yep. Remember that? Maybe back in school? I remember mine. I was in high school. It was my long-term girlfriend. We're up at a church winter camp, and she cheated on me with another guy. I know, right? And then she came up to me with tears in her eyes. Well, I think we should see other people. And I said, oh, you're going to be seeing other people, all right. Okay. It was over. Now she, I might have told you, she was the pastor's daughter, okay? So I know, I was getting into trouble in the first place. What was I thinking? But so we get back to the church parking lot, and all the parents are there to pick up, you know, their kids, and I've got my stuff, and the pastor's there. And he's, you know, he has no idea what happened, right? He's all, hey, Jim, how's it going? How was camp? And I said, your daughter cheated on me and broke up with me. That's how it was. And he goes, oh, I'm so sorry. Let me pray for you. I said, I don't need your pastoral care right now. Okay, but I remember he took me over to the side. He put his arm on my shoulder and he said, you know what? I love my daughter, but between you and me, you're probably better off. So just come. So, man, I tell you, I remember that. You know, if you got a heart, there's a good chance it's going to get broken, right? And not just in those teenage relationships, but, you know, things that are more serious. People in our family, our marriages, our kids, our parents, you know, our hearts can get broken there. Our hearts can get broken with loss. With illness, you know, why did my relative have to go through this, or why do I have to go through this? You know, broken hearts can come in the form of broken dreams, or struggles with our jobs or our career, and it can also come in our struggle with sin. And it's really how we respond determines how we're gonna come out of it. I mean, we can choose to become bitter, right, in our brokenness, just hold on to it and become resentful, or we can choose to get better. We can choose to just stay stuck, or we can choose to move forward. So this morning, we're gonna talk about what it means to move from a broken heart to a grateful heart. Because here's the good news. Jesus is in the business of healing our broken hearts. Amen? I mean, you think about it. In Jesus' ministry, he sought out the hurting. He sought out the sick and the ill. He sought out the outcast and the sinner. So I think the question that I'd like us all to ask ourselves as we're preparing to hear from God's word today is this: what's the condition of my heart? What's the condition of my heart? Man, you know, for some of us, we're honest. You know, yeah, our hearts are joyful. They're full. We're grateful. But others, you know, you might say, you know, honestly, my heart is hurting right now. Or some might even say, my heart's broken. Well, there's a message for all of us here this morning. As we eavesdrop on a dinner party that Jesus was invited to. And the two main characters in our story this morning have two very different hearts. And we're going to explore that today in the Gospel of Luke. But before we do, let's talk with God. Father in heaven, thank you for this time together. Lord, we all come on a Sunday morning in different places. Some of us are doing great. We are hopeful, we're expectant, we're joyful. And others of us have experienced things that actually have kind of made our hearts heavy. Might even be broken. Lord, I pray that you would encourage those who are hurting. That you would strengthen and challenge those who are doing well today. And that your word would make an impact on all of our lives. In your name we pray, amen. So, if you've got your note sheets, take those out. And we're going to look at the statement. What are the steps we can take to move from a broken heart, a hurting heart, to a grateful heart? And the first is this. We need to take our broken hearts to Jesus. Now, that might seem kind of obvious, but there's a lot of times we'll hold on to our hurt. We'll hold on to our bitterness and our pain and even our sin, and we won't give it to the Lord. Well, let's get into our passage. So it says in Luke chapter 7, and let's all get there if you've got a Bible. Luke chapter 7, if you've got it on your phone. And we're going to start at verse 36. So it says, now one of the Pharisees asked Jesus to eat with him. You know, it's interesting. You'll see a lot of these different stories in the Gospels where Jesus was invited to go have dinner, okay? And a lot of times he went. So one of the Pharisees, and that was one of the religious leaders of the Jews at that time, asked him to eat with him, and he went into the Pharisee's house and reclined at table. Now, let's get a little background here, a little context. The Pharisees, these religious leaders, they were well aware of the ministry of this new young rabbi that was traveling up and down Israel proclaiming the kingdom of God, salvation in the name of God, and teaching the people. But he was different. He wasn't your kind of run-of-the-mill religious leader, Pharisee, if you will. He taught with an authority that the people saw was different, like he really knew God. Go figure. He would minister to the sick, to even the dying, with signs and wonders. They probably heard of healing lepers. Sight was recovered to the blind and hearing to the deaf. The lame could walk. As a matter of fact, right before our passage here in Scripture, Jesus raised a man from the dead. So you can imagine how these stories started to spread like wildfire amongst the people, and the Pharisees were threatened. They were threatened of Jesus' ministry. Why? Because he was more popular than they were. Because he had more power than they did. And so I think our Pharisee here in our story, he wanted to check Jesus out for himself. So he invites him to dinner, and it says that they reclined at table. Now, it seems like something that you just pass over when you read it, but it's actually pretty important to our story this morning. See, you and I, we sit down at a table, and we have a chair, right? In the Jewish culture, at that time, they reclined at table. Now, that doesn't mean everybody had a lazy boy, all right, or anything like that. But the tables were lower, and they were kind of in a U shape or a circle, and the food was in the middle. And the guests would come to a banquet or a feast, and there were cushions all around, and they would actually get down, and they would be laying down, and they would be leaning on an elbow with their feet out behind them, and they would take the food and eat this way. That's what it meant to recline at table. Now we go on in verse
37, "And behold, a woman of the city who was a sinner, when she learned that Jesus was reclining at the table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of ointment." Now, my first question is, she wasn't invited. What was she doing there? Again, at that time, in that culture, one of the customs was, is that when a feast or a banquet was held, the poor and the needy could actually come. They'd have to remain kind of on the outskirts. They weren't to really interact. But when the meal was over, they could get the leftovers. So culturally, people could actually come. So a woman came, it tells us. And it says that she was a sinner. A sinner of the city. Now, many times we would interpret that as she was probably a prostitute. Probably, you know, this woman didn't have a lot of support. She didn't have a husband. She was a woman of pain and sorrow. She was a woman who was perhaps taken advantage of or abused by many men. And she had a reputation in the city as a sinner. And she hears of this dinner where this holy man, Jesus, was going to be right in her town, being held by a Pharisee. And so she comes. And it tells us that she brought an alabaster jar, a little jar with some ointment in it. Now, what's going on here? It tells us in verse 38, "And standing behind Jesus at his feet," so Jesus is reclining at the table, eating, "she comes in behind him. And she was weeping. And she stands over Jesus with her broken heart, in repentance, seeking his love, and standing behind Jesus at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears." Can you imagine? This woman comes in knowing who she is, knowing what she's done, but also recognizing that Jesus was from God, and that he could heal, and that he could forgive. And so she comes to him, and she's standing at his feet, and she just becomes overwhelmed, and she's weeping. And you can picture her tears falling on Jesus' feet. So she kneels down, and she wiped them with the hair of her head. She kissed his feet and anointed them with the ointment. One of the most loving expressions for me in all of Scripture, the picture of this broken woman bringing her life and her gift to Jesus. And you wanna deal with that broken heart? Don't hold on to the anger and the bitterness. Bring it to Jesus. And that's what she did. When I read this passage, I think of a time back in 2009 where I was leading a mission trip with a bunch of teenagers in the country of Ecuador. And we were really high up in the mountains there. And the city was called Ambato. And we were doing vacation Bible schools with kids in different villages and schools. And we were doing street evangelism. We were doing work projects. And we had this really cool bus driver. He was a local guy. He was an elder in his church. He was connected with those that were hosting our team. And it was really fun because he would take us different places where he was doing ministry. And on one day, he came up to me with a big smile. "Hey, Pastor Jim, guess where we're going today?" And I said, "I don't know, where?" He goes, "We're going to go to the prison." And I'm thinking to myself immediately, would the parents of my students appreciate that? So, a prison, all right, tell me about it. He says, "This is actually the worst prison in town. All of the really bad people go here." I said, "What do you mean by bad people?" He said, "Oh, you know, the drug dealers, the murderers, the thieves, all those guys." And I said, "Okay." So he said, "Is that all right?" So we prayed about it, we talked about it, and we went. So So we go to this prison, and sure enough, man, we came in, and they checked us all out, the whole bit, but he had made arrangements, and we had gotten permission to go. And we came in, and he took us to the women's side of the prison. And the plan was is that our students were going to prepare kind of the drama that they had that depicted what Jesus did for us on the cross, and then some of them were going to share their testimonies. I thought, okay. And some of the women were coming out, and there were guards there and everything, and I thought, okay, this looks good. And just as we're ready to start, he taps me on the shoulder, and he says, "Hey, Pastor Jim, you got to come with me." I said, "But I can't leave my kids." He goes, "They're all right. You've got your staff, your leaders there." I go, "What do you want me to do?" He goes, "We want you to preach to the men." By myself? "Well, what about them?" He goes, "Yeah, I'll be with you. It's okay." And so he starts leading me, and seriously, like this huge iron gate with, you know, barbed wire everywhere, and there's guards there with their guns, and I'm looking like, "Lord, I don't know if this is a good idea. I don't know about this." They open up this gate, and I'm in the yard, okay, just freely, and there's all these prisoners there. Like I said, murderers and thieves and drug dealers and all this stuff. And they're looking at me, and the vibe was kind of like this. Like, you know, I was like, wow, not a happy place. And I was nervous, man. I was scared. And so they walked me through the yard and into this chapel. And the chapel was maybe as large as one of the sections here of chairs. And I came in, and it was filled with men. They had heard that an American pastor had come, and they wanted to hear the Bible taught. And so I shared with them the good news about Jesus, and I had an interpreter. And I'll never forget, the reason I tell you this story, I'll never forget when I gave them an opportunity to give their lives to Jesus. When I prayed the prayer with them, men were weeping. These prisoners, in their brokenness, were weeping in their chairs. And then they came forward, and they knelt down, and they were sobbing. They were grabbing my pant leg, and they were looking up and just saying, "Lord, forgive me, I'm a sinner." And I was praying for each one of them, the brokenness that they had felt, and the gratitude that they had experienced in their salvation with the Lord. You know, the Bible tells us in Psalm 34 that the Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. I encourage them with those words. You know, I think of David, a guy who, you know, committed adultery and then in deception, tried to cover it up, and then he murdered someone. And then he was confronted with his sin. And in that confrontation, God finally got a hold of David's heart. And in brokenness, he wrote Psalm 51. And he writes this in verse 17, "The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise." Maybe you come with a broken heart today. Could be for a variety of reasons, but for some, it's because of our sin. And we know we're not living for the Lord, but as you can see, the Bible invites us. Come. God's looking for broken and contrite hearts. He will not despise them. God invites us to bring our broken hearts to Him and experience His love, His healing, and His forgiveness. Second step is we need to remember to turn away from a hardened heart. Because that can happen too. You know, we're hurt. Someone lets us down. Someone doesn't come through. Someone betrays us. Doesn't treat us kindly. And we can hold on to that hurt and nurture it. I want to tell you this morning, turn away from those feelings. Turn away from a hardened heart. What's a hardened heart? It's a heart that rejects God's truth and love and purpose for their lives time and time and time again. That's a hardened heart. Now, Jesus' host, this Pharisee, we're going to see that he's got the makings of a hardened heart. I mean, the Pharisees in that time, these religious leaders, yes, they devoted their lives to study God's word, to teach the people, to be examples, to not break any of the commandments, and yet they lost their love for people. See, they loved to go in the marketplace and people would greet them. That spoke to their superiority. They loved it when they were invited to a banquet and they got the chief seats. Here, you sit here. You're important. You're somebody. They liked that. Tell you what they didn't like was Jesus in his humility, in his power, and his authority. And so it tells us in verse 39, back to our story, this whole scene is happening. There are other people at the banquet in this Pharisee's house. Jesus is kneeling down, he's eating, and there's this woman behind him at his feet in her brokenness, in her repentance, and she's sobbing uncontrollably. She's crying. Her tears are falling on Jesus' feet. She kneels down. She's wiping them with her hair, and she takes out this ointment that she had brought, this perfume. She's kissing his feet, and she's anointing them. And the Pharisee, the host, his home, he's looking at this whole spectacle. And it says in verse 39 of Luke 7, now when the Pharisee who had invited Jesus saw this, he said to himself, if this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what sort of woman this is who is touching him, for she is a sinner. Can you feel his superiority? Can you feel his judgmentalism? Can you feel his lack of love? He's saying, oh yeah, Jesus, you're a big deal, huh? The people are calling you a prophet. They're saying that, oh, God has visited us now. I don't think so. I mean, look at you. You are allowing this known sinner, this woman, this prostitute, to come and touch you? That makes you ceremonially unclean. You're not even supposed to continue the meal because of what you're allowing this woman to do. You disgust me, Jesus. A prophet. Yeah, right. Wow. You know, we need to beware of allowing our own hearts to turn hard to God first, but to our spouses, our parents, our kids, our neighbors, those who might be different than us ethnically or socioeconomically, you know, whatever it might be. We've really got to watch that. It doesn't honor God at all. On another mission trip, had some teenagers, and we were in downtown LA ministering to the homeless, and the mission organization that we went with, they gave us an assignment, and they sent our teams, and we usually had a leader or two with some students, and we'd go out in the different streets in downtown LA, and they gave us an assignment. Here's $20. You need to buy your team lunch and bring a homeless person with you and get to know them and share the love of Jesus with them. So I had a group. I had four teenagers with me, and we're out on the streets, and they found a gentleman. He was homeless. He looked the part. He was living on the streets. You could smell the odor. His hair was disheveled. His clothes were torn. He was a man in need. And my student said, hey, can we take you to lunch? And he said, yeah, okay. So we took a couple of steps, and then he stopped. He said, can my girlfriend come? They were living under a bridge in L.A. And the kid said, well, sure. And she was just about the same shape as he was. We took a couple more steps, and then the man said, well, how about my three friends? Can they come? So I'm starting to count. All right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6... you know, I hope the dollar menu is doing real well at McDonald's today, because that's pretty much where we're going, if we can pull that off. So we had this caravan, and we go to McDonald's, and we go inside, but the homeless people stayed outside. And we said, come on in. And they said, we can't. They don't allow us in there. They don't want us in there. Maybe you can just get the food and bring it out. And my students were like, no, it's okay. You're with us. Come on in. So they kind of reluctantly, they walked into that McDonald's with us. And so the students were sitting down with the homeless people, and they started to talk and hear their stories. And the students were sharing with them, and they were sharing with my students. And I went to see if I could, you know, feed 10 people with $20 at McDonald's. So I'm trying to order the food. And then in walks in a policeman, and he sees what's going on, and he addresses the homeless people that were sitting with my students, and he says, hey, you guys, get out of here. You're not supposed to be in here. Quit bothering these kids. And one of my students, her name was Jenny, and she was this little blue-eyed, blonde-haired, you know, girl, right? And she says to the officer, it's okay, officer, they're with us. And the officer goes, and who are you? She goes, I'm Jenny from San Diego. He goes, all right. And I saw him kind of under his breath. He says, listen, these characters you got here, they're probably addicted to drugs. They're messed up. There might be mental illness. And they might have weapons. Really, it's in your own best interest that you don't hang out with them. And I was coming back to the table by then, and little Jenny just, she talked to the police officer. She said, it's okay. We're just having lunch with them, and we're going to share Jesus with them. Yeah, go Jenny, exactly. And the policeman just kind of looked, and he just said, good luck, whatever. And he walked out. Now, I get it. He had to deal with that kind of situation all the time. Yet what a contrast. The open heart of this teenage girl and this man whose heart was getting dangerously close to being hardened. You know, the Bible tells us in the book of Proverbs, chapter 28, verse 14, says, blessed is the one who fears the Lord always. Always. No matter what your circumstances are, no matter who you're interacting with, blessed is the one who fears the Lord. And that doesn't mean you're afraid of the Lord. That means that you have a healthy acknowledgement of who God is in your life. And then it goes on, but whoever hardens their heart, they'll fall into calamity. Here's my point. That Pharisee, he was a sinner. The woman was a sinner. We all owe a debt to God, don't we? And the Bible tells us in the book of Romans, chapter 6, verse 23, that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is what? Eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord. That's the good news. So beware that hardened heart. And then finally, as we come to Jesus, as we open our hearts to him, as we give him our pain and our past, our present, and our future, we thank him for his forgiveness. We thank him for his love. We thank him for all that he has done for us. We thank the Lord with a grateful heart. Now, back to our story. So the woman is kissing Jesus' feet in a public setting at this meal as he's reclining at table. She's starting to anoint his feet with this costly perfume that she brought. And the host, the Pharisee, is thinking to himself, she's a sinner. This isn't right. And this man is no prophet. And guess what? Jesus knew what he was thinking. So cool, right? He's God. He knows exactly what's going on in this guy's mind. And so Here's how Jesus responds in Luke 7, verse 40. And Jesus answering said to him, Simon, so we find out the Pharisee's name was Simon, I have something to say to you. And he answered, well, say it, teacher. A certain moneylender had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii. A denarii was like a day's wage. And one of these owed the moneylender 500 denarii. That's about a year and a half's worth of wages. And the other person owed him 50 denarii, about 2.5 months. When they couldn't pay, the moneylender canceled the debt of both. Now, Jesus asked, which of them will love him more? And Simon answered, the one, I suppose, from whom he canceled the larger debt. And Jesus said to him, you have judged rightly. So great. Jesus kind of baits this guy into it, right? He tells him a story. Now, the connections are pretty obvious. The money lender is Jesus, is God himself. We all have a debt that we owe to the Lord, the debt of our sin. And the person who owed 500 denarii, that's like the sinful woman. She's a big sinner. And the person who didn't know that much, 50, that was the Pharisee. But Jesus said, listen, none of them could pay. And so the moneylender, me, my father, their debts are forgiven. Now, Simon, who loves the most? And he said, probably the one that was forgiven the most. And he says, you're right. And now Jesus helps him connect the dots. And look what he says in verse 44. Then, turning towards the woman, Jesus said to Simon, do you see this woman who's at my feet? He says, I entered your house and you gave me no water for my feet. Culturally, you were supposed to have some water available so your guests could wash their feet because they're out walking around in sandals in the dirt. That was an appropriate thing to do. And Jesus says, you didn't give me any water for my feet, but she has wet my feet with her tears. What a picture. And wiped them with her hair. Verse 45, hey, Simon, you didn't give me a kiss. You didn't give me the appropriate greeting or kiss at the door. But since I came in, she has not ceased to kiss my feet. Hey, Simon, you didn't anoint my head with oil. Guests were offered oil for refreshing from the dirt and the heat. But this woman, she has anointed my feet with ointment. I mean, look at it. He's saying, listen, this woman, she's come to me in her brokenness. She's come to me with a repentant heart. She's washed my feet with tears of repentance. She's kissed my feet as an expression of love. She has anointed my feet with an expensive ointment as a gift of gratitude. And you did nothing. The one forgiven much loves much. That's what Jesus is trying to tell him. So he says in verse 47, therefore I tell you, Simon, her sins, which are many, are forgiven. Isn't that good news, folks? Amen. Isn't that good news? For she loved much, but he who is forgiven little loves little. And he said to her, your sins are forgiven. Wow. Yeah. Saying, Simon, you're missing the point. You might be trying to obey everything in the law, and that's good. There's nothing wrong with that, but you've kind of lost your heart. You've lost your focus with what God really wants to do in your life. You've rejected me in what you've heard of my ministry. You smirk at the idea that I might be a prophet, or that God might have visited his people in me. You're not buying it at all, and you're treating this poor woman with contempt. You don't even care about her. That's why I've come. for the broken, for the lost, for those who need the love of God. And he says in verse 48, he said to the woman, with Simon right there, your sins are forgiven. Your sins are forgiven. Then those who were at the table with him began to say amongst themselves, well, who is this who even forgives sins? Jesus ignored them. And he said to the woman, your faith has saved you. Go in peace. Amen. Go in peace. Glory to God. Glory to God. Isn't that awesome? Because of her faith, because of her ability to recognize that she didn't want to live with that broken heart any longer, she brought it to Jesus. And he forgave her. And he loved her. And she responded in gratitude. Folks, where are you at? What kind of a heart did you come with today? I hope it's joyful and full and grateful. I'd love that. But the reality is that there are probably a lot of us here who have come with some hurt, with some heavy hearts, maybe even a broken heart. It can be for a number of reasons. Jesus says, come. Come to me, all you who are weary and heavily burdened, and I will give you rest. I'll give you rest for your souls.